Good afternoon.
Who are participating in this session. I hope this session will be very useful to you. In Corona-19 period, SAR helped a lot for the government. Is having excellent projects given by the state and central government projects. I think he will discuss regarding that also. 90% of components of the medical field are manufactured in this COVID-19 season. Even though it is a costly process, we are in need of that type of process. I think he will discuss regarding that also. Okay, I will hand over the session to Sridhar sir.
Yeah, good afternoon, Dr. Karunakaran, and good afternoon to all the participants. I'm Sridhar Kumar, Senior Manager, taking care of PhD Typhocore activities at PhD College of Technology in Coimbatore. Before going to the presentation, I will just brief about the center where we are working. This is a center established under the project called TYFAC, under Ministry of Science and Technology. Probably most of us, we know the expansion for TYFAC-CORE, Technology Innovation Forecasting Assessment Council, and CORE is Center of Relevance and Excellence. So we specialized in product design. This center was a PPP model where public-private partnership was involved. Government of India through DST financially supported this project, and PhD College of Technology was the executing agency. And Precord was the industrial partner when it was established in 2000. And the main objective of this center was to support the academic and as well as industries, specifically in the area of how this product development commerce can be effectively used in the industry, how to reduce the product development time, and training the engineers, developing engineers, in the academic institution level in the advanced technology of additive manufacturing in 2000 I am talking about. And the basic facilities when it was started was additive manufacturing. Generally we call it as rapid prototyping or layer manufacturing, or nowadays largely we talk about 3D printing. The first machine was procured by PSG in 1997. For its own usage. After once established the center, along with the SLS machine, what purchased in 1997, there was one FDM machine also included into that. Then there was one already, so a 3D scanner, touch probe based scanner, and then vacuum casting facility was established at the time. And later on, management upgraded this facility twice. One was with a new thrice, one was with a new SLA system from 3D systems, stereo lithography system, and then one Fortus 900 MC from Stratasys, and then a GOM 3D scanner, that is a Blu-ray scanner from a company called GOM from West German, and then one more SLA system recently included with the bigger build platform from a company called Shining 3D from China. So we are extending services to more than 120 industries, which include a lot of automobile companies, aerospace, consumer products manufacturing, medical industries, and as well as academic institutions. So I am basically from a chemical background, working in additive for last 15 years. Largely in plastic, and recently last 5-6 years concentrating on metal additive manufacturing also. So this is the brief introduction about the center and myself about the involvement of our this thing in additive. Let us go to presentation now. Probably you might have heard a lot about additive world in the last 4 days of the event. In this program, most probably almost all the things might have been explained, but as a service provider and extending services to industries and also training the students, More than 6,500 students from various engineering institutions visited this center in the last 5 years. 6,500 students being visited this center, and we are conducting one-day workshop for the students' benefit to get explore into this technology. So the first session, some 3 hours, we used to give the presentation about the various developments happened in additive manufacturing. The afternoon after lunch, the students will be permitted to come inside the center, and they can practically see how the additive machines, that means industrial grade machines, are working. There are a lot of additive people are talking. They are all talking with the desktop machines. Maybe that is the technology machines. When we talk about industrial grade machines, which will be largely used for the manufacturing. So the students will get opportunity to see that, and also how the re-engineering and 3D modeling kind of work will support for the small scale manufacturers who are all not able to invest on their own for the re-engineering or 3D modeling or additive manufacturing. So that is the other thing I think I would like to bring to your knowledge, to all the faculties. So this is one of this kind of facility. So the students will get benefited from this lot. So why we will come to this one, probably with our basic knowledge. Additive was, or the rapid prototyping was the right term when we talk about this particular technology somewhat around 20-25 years before, was introduced into industry to support the industry to produce the proto model within short period. We all know that the product development process with involved with the 8 categories generally involved in industry, the strategy, then idea generation, then screening, which one would be suitable, then concept, then business analysis, product development, market analysis, manufacturing and commercialization. So in those days, we all very well know that once the concept is developed, then the 2D drafting would be done, and then feasibility to manufacturing would be analyzed by developing engineering for that. Then a proto model would be developed by using alternate materials, generally by using wax or plaster paris or wood. These are the material largely used in proto model development. I'm talking about just prior to development of CNC or CAD/CAM. So that was the reason. Example, if you take it in automotive side, the history of ambassador vehicle, probably our generation know very well about it. The time duration between Mark 1 to the development of Mark 2 model, and then to Mark 3 and Mark 4, the Hindustan Motors took nearly 7 to 8 years time, because the proto development was consuming long time, and also the design, finalization, execution of designing and analysis, everything was time consuming process. So the industry was eagerly searching to substitute the right technology, not only for designing and even for the proto model development, to reduce the time involvement or time consumption happened in a new product development, so that the industry can able to produce or execute lot of new products into the market. So I can strongly say here that the CAD/CAM development and inclusion of additive manufacturing in the new product development supported the industry to produce enough number of new products per annum. Lot of new products being developed and put it in their library, and whenever it is required, bringing one from there, here and there, and a new model will be launched soon. This used to happen in the automobile segment largely, that too in two-wheeler segment. So when I was comparing the ambassador model and comparing to the present day automotive side, a lot of new vehicles are launching day to day, and these are all happened because of reduced time in a new product development. So the rapid prototyping was very much essential for the new product development. So there was a lot of study happened in the 80s, So here I have, you can see this slide, traditional process of product designing or a linear chain where the customer will give the input and marketing personnel will bring the idea in new product development, because they can each and everybody can express this ideas. And nowadays the service section also would be strongly playing a lot of role in the new product development, because they can categorically they can come out with what are the problems which the industry is facing in the existing products and how it can be rectified. That feedback we can be able to get it from the service side. So this is a concurrent engineering or team collaboration. So you can see here when with this input, there was a technology first established was the spirography in additive manufacturing, SLA generally we call it, 1987. And this was effectively commercialized in the early 90s. And that industry, that particular technology was supporting the industry in developing proto model in a fast manner, rapid manner. So that is the reason it was largely used as rapid prototyping technology. So how it was supported the industry in the early stage, five key benefits you can see here, realizing the design concepts, incorporating the changes instantly, saving cost and time, and customizing the design would be easy, minimizing the design flaws. So whoever coming to our center for development of proto model, specifically we talk about metal side, we used to produce patterns by using additive manufacturing technology for the investment casting. This pattern will directly replace the wax patterns used in lost wax technology, investment casting technology. So there, what the customer regularly does, they used to place order for 10 numbers in the initial stage itself. Then initial two numbers they will take and take it to casting and produce the metal model and take it for analysis and even the functional testing. And again, they incorporate the changes. Suddenly, within another 15 days, they used to come and again take two more. And again, they used to validate in such a way, within short period, a complete product can be easily developed. So this is the advantage of using additive. And it saves cost and as well as time, because the conventional method of producing the rapid proto models by using either wood or wax or clay or chalk, whatever it is, requires a lot of support of craftsmen, a lot of tools and machinery requirements will be there. So that and all can be completely eliminated here, so that you can save a lot of cost there, and also the time can be saved, and perfection of the output would be there, higher priority here. Generally, when we talk about designs, we used to say a term called design loss or communication loss happened in the process of various process of proto model development. So in those days, most of the proto model development people are skilled in particular thing. For example, if we use wood as the material, then we have to get a proper carpenter for that. They may be semi-skilled in the engineering side. So understanding whatever the communication we give to them, it will not be completely absorbed by them. So there will be possibility for loss of lot of information, so that the final output what we receive from the conventional method of proto development, we end up with lot of complications. So further, the customizing design is also not that much easy. So this particular technology can give all these benefits. So probably you might have understand about the technology. It's basically a layer manufacturing. Generally, it was called earlier. The development of parts happened in this layer by layer by receiving a CAD file as input. So once the CAD data given to the machine will be having a two part. One is the software side. The other part is the hardware manufacturing side. The software side can slice your CAD data into number of layers. So you can opt for the layer thickness according to you. Every machine will be having different layer thickness options, and you can reduce the layer thickness or increase the layer thickness according to your requirement. So reducing the layer thickness will increase the production time, and cost of production will definitely increase. And when we go for the thicker layers, then definitely the production time would be reduced, cost of production reduced, but the surface roughness would be more. So these are the impact of layer there. So you can, in this slide, you can easily compare the conventional subtractive manufacturing, how it differs from the additive manufacturing. You can see in the conventional side, in the subtractive manufacturing, loss of wastage would be generated here, whereas here the wastage generation will be lesser. And further, if you see any complicated features which subtractive manufacturing could not able to do, can be easily carried out in additive. So that's the advantage of additive over subtractive manufacturing. And as I have told, it is one among the manufacturing activities that leads to reduction of product development time. Generally, the additive manufacturing, generally we call it as manufacturing, but it has not been largely used for manufacturing so far. But the developments are happening in the machine side, how this technology can be effectively used for the regular manufacturing also. So when we talk about this, metal additive manufacturing is largely used to produce components for the specific requirement that we will see in the later slide. So far largely used for automobile development, and now diverting it to the regular manufacturing. So the developments are happening in the industry. And how your machine can work, you can see here, your 3D CAD model would be given as a input in your STL format, and there will be a slicing software which slices your CAD data into a number of layers. So you have to orient the model in a proper way, either in a vertical or in a horizontal, appropriate to the requirement what you are having. In case if you, for example, this one, if you keep it in the vertical side, it consumes more time, but the quality of the output would be good. When you prefer a horizontal orientation, the production time can be reduced, but give a lot of opportunity for the development of support material. So the costing vary. So all these aspects, quality requirement and costing, would be taken into account to fix the orientation. And then you can enter into slicing side. You can fix the layer thickness, what exactly you require. So accordingly, your CAD data would be sliced into number of layers. And once the layer slices are over a two-part generation and given to the manufacturing of the machine, the additive machine, the final output be generated here. We will, it's a cycle you can see here, the same thing. So why prototype required, all this thing is the industry requirement. Generally, this presentation was made about, or largely about, how this technology would be meeting the challenges in prototype manufacturing in the industry. Professor was telling that during this pandemic time, we have been asked to work even from March 29, received the instruction from, since it is a government supported lab, we received instruction from the health ministry, because sudden development of pandemic, there will be the huge requirement of ventilators in the medical application. So India was not not prepared that much well to meet this eventuality. So we have been asked from Government of India through the district administration to support all the ventilator and other medical manufacturing industries, because there will not be, because all the industries being closed, and there is no possibility for the tool development, which consumes more time. And most of the body parts of the ventilator being produced in additive manufacturing using a huge platform of Focus 900 MC, what we have here, the built volume of 900 by 600 by 900 mm, with more than 5 different kind of material option, given opportunity to medical industry to produce most of the body parts of the ventilators and other medical equipments by using additive manufacturing. So we were completely working, we were completely engaged for the 3 months without taking even a holiday. Our team, 8 members team, was worked and supported the hospital requirements. probably till June, we were completely engaged in that. So we have supported to produce the most of the body component, inclusive kind of thing for the ventilators to a lot of industries located in various part of industry. Government was asking most of the medical equipment manufacturing industries to enter into the development of ventilator to meet most of the requirement with the domestic production. So that was the environment we have shown. So this photo, when we talk, that is the thing, you know, most of the presentation you can see here how this one will support the protomodern development. So we are supported a lot of government organizations. ISRO is one of our main clients, produce patents for investment casting to them. More than 14 years we are working with BSSC and also to ADA, NAL, HAL, ICIL, DRDO labs, various DRDO labs like DRDL kind of thing for their requirement. So in most of the cases, the initial development comes with a scaled down version to understand the design properly and also to communicate effectively about the product features to the various people like tool engineers, process planners, manufacturing engineers. And some of the industries use this one to produce a scaled down version to give it to the marketing personnel to carry into the market, produce some 50-60 parts so that the marketing personnel can carry the prototype models to the industry, to the clients to understand about the new product, how the industry observation and how acceptance and all. So to make a market survey also they used to do, and also for design checking. And some of the material development happened in the recent past to support the proto models to use for various kind of analysis, which includes flow and stress, another kind of thing. And moreover, the people can, any complex geometry comes or complex assembly comes, any interference during assembly can be easily diagnosed in the product development stage itself to eliminate the complications of the production. So these are the things where the additive can, and you can see here various areas how effectively the additive manufacturing is used in general application, motor and consumer business machines, medical, academic, aerospace, government and military, especially their segments, which includes consumer products and all. So where this would be largely used also, you can see here, 3D printers have reduced the development process of any product from months to days. And engineers can easily test ideas easily within short period. No need of waiting like anything. Any new concept developed, they can easily give to additive side, produce and understand whether it can be commercially viable. Because in industry, while you are carrying your new concept to your superior in industry, taking something on computer or on a paper will not give opportunity to explain in depth about your idea to your superiors, where it will support large. And then doctors largely use these facilities. It supports them for the surgical reversals, generally we call it as, to reduce the surgery time. I will explain you in the later slides about it. These are some of the challenging areas the additive is using. Used actually, the Tyfac was used, made a first attempt in 2003 for the medical application. I have the history of that in the later presentations. And the three-dimensional visual products act as amusing learning aids for the students. That is the other beautiful opportunity, specifically in the medical side. In the critical cases, they can able to produce the proto model, because getting cadavers for the individual students in the medical application is not possible at present day, that too for the private medical colleges. So we were in the process of developing a synthetic cadaver system for the medical students. It's going on. Now we could able to develop some of the organs where the students can do all the surgical learning with that one, where it will be used as a teaching aid, and this eliminates a lot of, you can see in architecture also, and product developers can discuss market potential that they do. Industries used to come and produce some 200, 300 parts, proto models, scaled-up versions, and give to their clients to understand how the product will be absorbed in the market. And tool and die side also, whom I can verify design before investing in a very expensive molding tools. They used to produce their tool by using additive. And even we can see conformal tooling channels for the tool development, which would be critical to produce a conventional method of manufacturing, can be easily produced in additive manufacturing. Probably you might have, when we talk about the tool manufacturing molds for the plastic injection molding, where the conformal cooling channels comes for the critical areas to increase the productivity and also to avoid the temperature variation or the thermal transmission, all these things. So that kind of critical parts can be easily produced in additive side. So these are the industries which take regular support from additive nowadays. You can see the foundry is one of the thing. Fashion industry, one of the fashion technologies will use the SLS technology available here to produce a 3D printed or additively manufactured overcoat, and won the national level first prize in the competition also. And even some sort of chapel manufacturing, shoe manufacturing, new concepts can be easily produced in additive to visualize them. Instead of seeing on the screen, if you get the real part on the hand, your experience will be entirely different. And pump and valve industry started using it largely to produce the impellers for the proto requirement to make the R&D. And jewelry accepted this one very well. As I said, you can see the conformal cooling channels for the mold and die making industry. Automobile and aerospace and defense are the other areas. You can see the roadmap where the 3D printing was started. Charles Hull invents the stereolithography to create 3D part in 1984. And this was commercialized. The first SLA machine was produced by 3D system and introduced into market successfully, though the development happened in 87, and the successful one was launched in 1992. And the PSG is having the advantage to produce the stereolithography machine in 1993 with support of DST. We developed our own machine in 1993. And you can see afterwards, PolyJet has come, FDM has been launched, all the developments happened later on. And this is, I don't know how effectively you could be able to see the slide, how the classification can be done. You can see the VAT polymerization here, material extrusion, material jetting, binder jetting, powder bed fusion, direct energy deposition, seat lamination. So these are the large level classification. It comes under additive manufacturing technologies. Under each category, there are again the subcategories. I don't know how could able to see, but I can see here, you can able to see stereolithography, SLA, digital light processing, DLP and CVLP, FDM, fusion deposition modeling, and material MJP, generally call it as MPG, and drop on demand, and binder jetting, like different kind of thing. And if you come to the end of this slide, you can see all these things are the metal additive manufacturing, direct metal laser sintering, or selective laser melting, or electron beam melting, laser beam melting, laser engineering, net shape lens, and electron beam additive manufacturing, and laminated object manufacturing. These are the various kind of technology we can classify. And some of them I will briefly explain here to for your knowledge. So VAT polymerization, the first one was stereolithography. There will be a liquid resin would be taken. I will explain you here. So these are the apparatus available here. 3D system is one of the major manufacturer of this machines in early stage. Nowadays, China is coming up, producing lithography machines largely for the global requirement. So here, the technology, you can see a moving piston here, mobile build platform. Generally, we call it as, it would be in touch with the piston here. And this is the elevator. And the vat is filled with photopolymer resin. The resin can solidify in case if you pass the UV rays over that. And you can see the laser source here and the scanner support would be there. So the 3D model would be taken from here. The scanner will, scalar mirror will view the 3D model from the software part of the machine and reflect the same thing. And it will be absorbed by the laser source and the laser will scan over the resin surface. So wherever the laser falls, the resin will get solidified. So generally, as I said, the, after the layering, slicing happens, one by one layer the scanning will be done and laser will absorb the information from on the bottommost layer and scan over the photopolymer resin available in the vat. So wherever laser falls, that area will be solidified. The rest of the area, the resin will be in the liquid state. So the first layer would be produced in the bottommost layer of, platform of the build platform. Then the next layer information happens, solidification, like layer by layer, the production happens. So that is the reason we call it as layer manufacturing. The working atmosphere and material specification and all managed in such a way to produce the part and also to maintain the adhesion between the internal layers when we talk about the plastic. And then next is the digital light processing. Probably you all know about or largely about this thing. We will give more importance for metal side because that was something new to our segment now. So this is basically again the photopolymerization only. So here the digital light will be used as a light source here. And if you're coming to fusel deposition modeling, FDM, where the raw material would be in a filament form, I think this video will give you the complete.
A rapid prototype starts as an STL file generated from a 3D CAD program. The model is oriented within the computer exactly as it will be built in the FDM machine. Orientation may affect build time, strength of features, and support material generation. Once the model is oriented, the software divides the model into evenly spaced planar sections, each measuring as small as a few thousandths of an inch. Supports are then generated for overhanging sections. Each layer consists exclusively of non-overlapping and non-intersecting curves. Tool paths are created in the regions, indicating whether the FDM machine should extrude model material or support material. Once the tool paths controlling the XY movements have been generated for all layers, a file is created and sent to the FDM machine. Inside the heated build envelope, the model material in filament form is heated to a less viscous state for extrusion. The model is built layer by layer from the bottom up. On each layer, the extrusion tips follow the tool paths calculated in the computer. After each layer is completed, the plate drops and a new layer is added. When the final layer is complete, the modeled part can be removed. After support material is removed, you are left with a strong, durable, and functional prototype.
So probably this video will explain you about the importance of orientation and the support material requirement. The orientation plays a lot of role, not only in plastic additive manufacturing and even the metal additive manufacturing. In metal additive manufacturing, even the orientation plays a lot of role in the functional properties also, metallurgical properties also, because it involved with a lot of thermodynamics and as well as the methodology. So the orientation plays a lot of role there, and how the residual stress can be eliminated by changing the orientation and changing the energy source, that are all the advantage and what are the detail. Whereas here in the plastic, the orientation will give the advantage of reducing the cost and also enhance the surface finishing. These two advantages you can be able to get. And I think the video was clearly explained about the requirement of support material. Wherever the elevated support comes, the machine software automatically generate the support material. So while you are feeding into the machine system, so the support for the elevated support profiles will be built from the scratch, itself, from the bottom layer itself. So once the build is completed, the support material will be removed and the model material can be retained for our requirement. Yeah, this is the machine mod we have now with us. A very big build platform of 900 by 600 by 900 mm can able to meet any kind of industrial requirement. This was supporting automobile side lot. A lot of automobile industries, whenever they're developing a new cars, they used to have one or two model cars for their internal usage. In most of the body parts, even for Mahindra, procured the machine probably some 4 years before. Prior to that, most of the body parts for their model cars been produced by using this machine, by using material of ABS M30. So that was the other one application, and you can find the other material is the Altum. What we have, Altum 9085. That one is the material largely used by aerospace industry, a high strength and high thermal material. And we have polyphenyl sulfur, PPSF, that also meet the requirement of producing the functional parts with high thermal requirements. And PC grade, you can see here, polycarbonate. What we have is a medical grade polycarbonate, which should be used not only for that and even the automobile side also. So the data sheets of all these materials are available in our website. And you can go through that. So we have five material options in this machine at PSG, ABS M30, PC, PC ABS, Altum 9085, and polyphenyl also. So a lot of models are available. What we have is the machine from a company called Stratasys from 3D Systems. Sorry, Stratasys from Germany. And when we talk about stereolithography, we have 3D Systems machine, one machine, and as well as a machine from a Chinese supplier called Shining 3D. So we have one more machine called Maxim, FDM Maxim from Stratasys also, but that has only one material option. We are not using that machine largely for present day requirement. That machine is purely, we are using it for an academic side. And material jetting, polyjet, where it's a beautiful technology, can support, you can see, to produce transparent and opaque, flexible, colored, everything in a single build. That is the advantage of this one. So largely accepted by the industry. Stratasys is the producer of this machine. J750, J850 was launched recently. A very big platform of build dimension 500, 400 by 200, largely used by the shoe manufacturers and as well as the medical application. You can see the any embedded systems inside can be easily produced, and this can be used for the academic side teaching. The spots can be used as a teaching aid for the academic requirement, and as well as any flexible requirement also can be produced here. So the advantage of this one is you can combine a lot of materials. You can able to produce rigid material, rigid parts, flexible parts, transparent part or colored parts, and as well as you can able to produce, you can see the various colors. So it would be largely used for the medical application. We don't have this machine with us actually, but taking services from Stratasys, we could able to use for the various medical application that I will explain you in the latter stage. Binder jetting is the other technology. Voxel Jet is one of the main company. They are producing sand mold for the foundry industry. Whenever the requirement comes with minimum quantity, and that will also record in your SOC span. This one will be largely used. It's basically a SHAN would be there, and over that we can see ink would be spilled over the SHAN, and wherever the profile is in that area, the ink would be spilled over, and then a temperature code can be then, and your recoder comes there, and you can see here, and probably this is the machine you can see here. So this is from OxygenJet, Germany. A little bit expensive, but support the foundry industry largely. And then if you come to MJF multi-jet fusion, again in the plastic side, powder bed actually, powder, the raw material will be in a powder bed side. I think we can see SLS and then come to here.
A CAD design is transferred to the center stage.
Before going to the slide, selective laser sintering was the first kind of technology promoted in a powder-based techniques. Here the raw material we have seen in the stereolithography, the photocurable resin was used as a material for the raw material. When we talk of the FDM, a thin filament, plastic filament will be used as a raw material. When we come to sintering kind of thing, the powder bit would be used as a powder would be used as a raw material. Here the laser would be positioned just above the build platform. The laser will scan the data from the 3D model, whatever we had given as the input, and scan over the powder. So it's a plastic powder. The laser will melt the powder and fuse the powder. Generally, we can see all the polymerases, the monomers will become polymers here by applying energy from laser source. You can see how it works.
A CAD design is transferred to the center stage. A roller then deposits a precise amount of powder over the building. The laser sinters or almost melts the powder to form a single layer of the prototype.
Each day,
the build area piston lowers and the roller deposits another layer of material to be sintered. This process continues, and in a matter of hours, the entire part has been built.
So here you might have seen the roller spreading over the build platform. It spreads the powder over the build platform. And then the laser source positioned just above or the platform will take the input from the CAD file, scan over the powder surface. So wherever the laser falls, that area will powder will get fused. The rest of the area powder will be retained in a powder form only. So in this technology, no support generation is required because uncured powder will act as a support material. This is the concept we can say reason for the development of DMLS technologies for the metal application in the latter stage. So we can I can play this slide once again, and each and every layer wants the laser polymerization or fusing over, then the build platform moves down by a layer. The distance it moves down, either here on SLA, the build platform moves down after each layer of manufacturing. The distance moves down is equivalent to the layer thickness what we prefer. So then there in SLA, the resin, uncured resin will be spread over the build platform. Whereas in SLS, uncured powder will be spread over the build platform. The next layer information will be taken by the laser. Then again, it would be scanned over the raw material, and the material will get fused, and internal layer adhesion also will be perfect here. I can see.
A CAD design is transferred to the sinter station. A roller then deposits a precise amount of powder over the build area. The laser sinters or almost melts the powder to form a single layer of the prototype. The build area piston lowers, and the roller deposits another layer of material to be sintered. This process continues, and in a matter of hours, the entire part has been built.
So this is the selective laser sintering machine what we have here. So almost what we are seeing here, all powder-based one. All these things are powder-based, powder bed fusion. Generally, we call it the fusion happens in a powder bed. So there are MJF and also HP has got a jet fusion also. But the material limitations are there in these machines. Not like as FDM is serving a range of material options. sintering process always will be having a material resistance. Largely nylon material is used here, and generally glass filled nylon and nylon 6 and nylon 66. These are the materials largely used here in powder wet fusion in prostate.
A CAD design is.
This is a machine what we have, not EOAS, what we have is a machine from 3D Systems in Germany. In fact, that machine was one of the oldest one. That machine was owned by some other company, 3D Systems taken over that company actually. Okay, so when we talk about the laser melting, we can talk about the metal also here, selective laser melting machine, powder bed fusion again. The powder, metal powder will be spread over a platform and laser source will scan the 3D model and melt the powder. It's a welding technology basically. It's a metal machine what we are seeing now from a selective laser SLM technology. The technology itself is called as SLM solutions. You can see the build envelope size of 500 by 365. Four lasers, or powerful lasers are required for metal compared to the plastics. Whereas here in SLS, what we use is the carbon dioxide laser, maximum of 50 watts or even sometimes 14 watts, 15 watts lasers also largely used. Low energy laser power is sufficient when we use it for a plastic. When it comes for the metal, we need a lot of energy for that. So you can see a single laser, 200 to 400 watts, and then a quad where 400 watts laser will be used actually. And these are the specification of this particular machine. And I would like to share a small information here. We have been awarded by DST to domestically produce a metal additive manufacturing machine at PSG. We are in the process of developing a metal additive manufacturing machine given by DST. We collaborated with IIT also Jodhpur, and we are producing that machine. But most of the manufacturing things are happening here. They are also involved with one size of platform, and we involved with, but not this one, that is direct energy, the position that I will explain to you in the next slide. So this one is the metal machine largely used in the industry. The other one is the DMLS, you can see here. I think it must be there after EVM. So this is also powder bed fusion. The energy source would be electron beam instead of laser, what we have seen in SLM or in DMLS. The electron beam is a highly energy source of 3000 watts. That means 3 kilowatts is the minimum thing. You can see the machine spec here. This company called Arcam from Sweden developed this technology. This machine was largely used by GE to produce particular valve system for the aerospace requirement, aerospace engine requirement. GE procured initially 2 machines from Arcam, they developed their own material, titanium aluminide, specifically to produce that valve system for the aerospace engine requirement. They patented both material and as well as the design of the valve. Initially, they procured 2 machines from Arcam and used it for the development of all the valve system and also some of the complex rotatory components for the aerospace requirement. And they procured day by day more machines. At one stage, they had more than 30 machines from Arcam, used it for various applications in the aerospace requirement. After some 3 years of usage of the machine, on fine day, they have taken over the company also, Arcam also. So now the company is owned by GE, and we got an opportunity to visit their headquarters both in Sweden, Gothenburg in Sweden, and also in their technology center in Germany. such a wonderful technology in metal additive manufacturing. Electron beam high energy source will be used here, so that the components produced by using this particular technology would be having a lesser residual stress compared to the laser based technologies. And moreover, this is the technology, the complete production happened in a vacuum atmosphere, because laser, when we talk about laser machines, we used to use inert atmosphere, either argon or helium will be used as the inert gas to produce the inert atmosphere. EBM cannot, because vacuum cannot be used in laser technology, whereas here the complete build happens in the vacuum atmosphere. So the contamination on the parts produced in this technology would be comparatively better. So that is the reason this technology is largely used to produce components for aerospace requirement and as well as for the medical application. Though the laser machines are largely used to produce implants, medical implants, specifically knee joints and hip joints, but EBM is the most advisable technology to produce medical implants. So this is one of the things you can have a small, this is a machine what we are seeing here. You can see this is the energy source. This is a heating, the energy source filament generate the electron beam. And here you can, two hoopers simultaneously, both the side to have a raw material. And this is the build platform. So the raw material powder will be spreaded over here, as like how we have seen in SLS. It will be spreaded over the platform here. The energy comes straight away from the top, and the material will be welded or fused here. Since it's a high energy, the production happens very fast compared to the laser machines. And as I said, because of the high energy and high thermal, the residual stress generated in the final product also comparatively lesser in EBM. It's a small
The additive manufacturing industry continues to accelerate as more and more businesses see the value in this revolutionary technology. Setting the pace is GE Additive's latest EBM innovation, a system that's enabling a new phase of high-volume industrial production. At the center of this next-generation system is the Arcam EBM Spectra H, a machine capable of producing parts at temperatures exceeding 1,000 degrees Celsius, has increased build sizes and speeds while simplifying operation. Spectra operates within a closed-loop system to create a dust-tight environment, ensuring powders are completely contained and never cross-contaminated or exposed to external elements. It starts in the powder hoppers, featuring an automatic shutoff valve that eliminates the risk of powder spilling. A new powder distribution system automatically creates a smooth, even layer for optimal part production. This simplified build preparation ensures reliability and repeatability while reducing dependency on manual operators. Key to Spectra H's ability to deliver market-leading high-temperature production is the newly designed build chamber. Movable heat shields create improved insulation, forming the ideal environment for exceptional part production. An auto-calibrated 6-kilowatt beam delivers a 100% increase in power to provide up to 50% faster builds, allowing manufacturers to begin transitioning into high-volume outputs. Boosting production capacity also comes from Spectra H's expanded build volume, 39% larger than the previous generation EBM machine. With this extended platform, it's possible to print larger parts than ever before and produce more parts at one time. And with Spectra H's high heat capability, users can incorporate new alloys such as titanium aluminide into production to expand their offerings, including high-temperature anti-corrosive materials. When the part build is complete, the entire build tank is removed and placed in the Spectra Powder Recovery System docking station to maintain powder integrity. Once in position, the part is cleaned with compressed air and powder. In the PRS, smaller particles are removed in a cyclone cleaner. After that, the powder passes through a magnetic separator to remove any metallic satellites picked up in the cleaning process. After the part is removed from the PRS, the loose powder is automatically transferred in a closed system to a barrel. The closed loop process is maintained as the sealed barrel is moved to a newly designed auto-dosing sieve, where oversized particles are separated, and the powder again passes through a magnetic separator. Faster builds, increased reliability, and leading production at high temperatures. The Spectra H and next-gen EBM system deliver a new level of capabilities, helping additive manufacturers do more in less time and grow their opportunities like never before.
So when we talk about additive manufacturing, it's a term can be pronounced easily. Probably POSTIC when it was introduced, because PSG was the first service provider in additive manufacturing in India, established in 1999, 2000 PSG type of code. The acceptance by the industry for this technology was not that much. And people felt that the technologies are highly complicated. But when more awareness been given, and then acceptance of POSTIC is in the enormous level now. Most of the industries would like to have their own machines for their application inside their campus itself. But when we talk about metal, it is still more complex. So it involves, it requires a lot of research to standardize your part and to make it as a functionally suitable for the application. That too, when we talk about using metal additive manufacturing for the aerospace and medical application, both the areas are highly critical, where the study of material and the technology is very, very important. So when we talk about the additive manufacturing generally for the medical application, we have visited a lot of centers in abroad and could able to see EBM was largely installed and getting approval from FDA for any of the products, implants produced at your unit would be easy because the technology and as well as the material is already got certified from FDA America, and FDA China also been given approval for this one. There is one implants manufacturing company in China installed more than 30 machines of this kind. Specifically to produce two kind of joints. One is the knee joint, mostly with cobalt chromium material, and the hip joints with titanium material. And apart from that, there are their leading manufacturers also, implants manufacturers also using this machine largely for the patient specific implants. That means customized implants. For example, a patient met with an accident where the complete replacement is not required. A partial replacement where, you know, the 3D model, I will explain you later stage how it would be done in the medical application. So in the medical application and aerospace application, this technology is playing a lot of role. When we talk about direct metal laser sintering, most of the laser machines are used in automotive side and as well as the tooling side and also general engineering side, where the material criticalness is not that much. But though we can't say that the DMLS or the laser machines are used in aerospace and as well as in medical side, they are also being used. But advisably, most of the leading manufacturers in the global level are preferring EBM for these two application largely. This is the thing, and you can see some of the parts produced. These are the implants you can see here, and some of the aerospace components. This is a spinal cord parts produced. This is a knee joint. This is a hip joint produced, and these are some of the parts produced in EBM. And this is the direct energy deposition. This I have told. One of the machine called DMD, direct metal deposition. The technology was developed by one professor from Michigan University, is a NRA, Professor Mazumdar. He developed that machine, and generally the technology is called as direct energy deposition. You can see here the advantage of this one is you can use multiple material in a single build. You can increase the powder feeding nozzle systems, probably it's not available here. You can see here, this is a powder feeding nozzle system. powder comes through this nozzle, this is the energy source. So you can multiple the nozzles, you can increase the nozzles, and in a single build, one particular air, you can build one particular material, and you can change the material in between also. So composites kind of attempt can be made here. But one disadvantage of this technology is the surface roughness. The part produced by using this technology would be having more surface roughness, but advantage is you can have a very huge build platform. You can go up to 1 meter, 2 meter also. You can see all other technologies, the build platform size, you can DMLS maximum 400, 400 by 400, EBM also, SLM also. Whereas here in there is no any platform restriction. You can go for the bigger platforms also by introducing, instead of CNC, you can robo heads can be used so that the reachability to all the platform corners also will be easy. We are into the manufacturing of this kind of machine, development of this kind of machine. Okay, and this is one of Optomec DED machine. You can see here the build platform size is huge here, 800, 600 by 600. That's an advantage. Multiple nozzle systems and energy source should be lesser here, should be lesser. We cannot use EBM here in this. These are the things, and you can see materials for various metal additive manufacturing. This is a laser powder bed fusion. This is a electron beam powder bed fusion. The advantage of laser machines, you can have a range of material. You can see various kind of materials are used. Starts from titanium grades and cobalt chromium, tool steel, stainless steel, inconel, aluminium of 2-3 grades have been introduced, copper, tungsten, and precious metals like gold, silver, and platinum. Whereas EBM having material restrictions to titanium and cobalt chromium, and to some extent in inconel and copper. Nowadays, because of the high energy source, aluminum cannot be used here. But steel grade people started using by using EBM. All the customization of the machine being done by the machine user, not by the company. So there are some people in China using stainless steel in EBM and as well as precious metals in EBM. So these are some of the material challenges available here. And you can see here, it's a GE part. I have not used courtesy GE here. And what you are seeing left side, it's a single nozzle system having more than 20 parts assembly in single unit in whatever you are seeing in the left side. Whereas the additively produced as a single component. So 20 parts assembly has been made as a single component. That's the advantage where you can able to reduce the weight by 25%. So in case of aerospace, the weight reduction is very, very important to reduce the fuel consumption and also to reduce the aircraft weight. So additive can strongly support that kind of requirement. And this is one of the product which GE was producing by using their own material called titanium aluminide, the patent material. And this is in the healthcare side, it's a hip joint or hip knee, generally produced in titanium. This is all the customized maxillofacial and the frenoplasty requirements. And this particular kind of requirement, DMLS would be ideal, manifolds basically. Where you know the DMLS is the advisable technology to produce this kind of manifolds. And when we talk about the tooling industry requirement, conforming cooling channels, definitely DMLS is having DMLS and SLM is having edge there. Laser machines can be used and to produce this kind of conforming cooling channels for the tooling requirement, where EBM cannot able to support because of the two reasons. EBM surface roughness would be more. So the cleaning the hollow channels is not that much easy. And the second thing, still EBM is not successfully used for the steel kind of, steel or aluminum kind of thing. Recent developments with the applicator level only it is being done, but the GE is not officially introduced stainless steel or aluminum as the material for EBM. So DMLS and SLM is largely covering tooling industry, specifically this this kind of conformal cooling channels development. And this is the topology optimization generally supported in metal additive side. You can see the very first component was like this, and without affecting this functional importance, the material removal happens like this, and the final part design would be like this. And here the advantage, cost of the material can be reduced and weight of the part also will be reduced. This is the one of the topology optimization option, which helps to reduce the weight and as well as the material cost without disturbing the functional requirement. You can see creation of structures with minimal mass and maximum stiffness. This is one of the options strongly used in metal additive side, successfully used for the aerospace application and as well as in the automobile side also. So these are some of the medical 3D printing in medical application. How it would be done, you can see the CT image would be used as the input, and then the DICOM image would be taken and converted into the STL, and this STL will be fed to the 3D printer, and the part would be produced. I will explain you how it would be done. So before going to the medical application largely, so I would like to conclude this here. What are the challenges first in additive side when we talk about, as I explained earlier, plastic additive manufacturing is largely used to produce the proto model, not being developed to the regular manufacturing because of the various reasons. One is the material, and second thing, a lot of material developments are happening in additive side also, and second thing is the volume and the cost involvement. I think once nowadays you can find even the FDM machines, tabletop machines, are costing with few dollars, $500 also one machine. One donor from Coimbatore procured 50 desktop FDM machines to donate to schools, to include school additive also one of the major curriculum side. So we supported them to procure at the cost of $500, small printer. So plastic developments are happening in the site, but still we may call it as additive manufacturing, but the effective utilization for the manufacturing in plastic side is restricted, depends upon the materials. So for example, producing components by using additive, definitely additive manufacturing can support. When we talk about producing large quantity of material by using ABS material, or probably plastic injection molding would be economical. And when we are producing a highly complex geometry where none of the technologies can support, where additive can support any production of any complex geometry. So that are the advantage in plastic side. When we come into metal side, material plays a lot of role. For example, titanium is a, you all know that it's a hard material. Machining of the titanium is not that much easy task. And casting of titanium also involved a lot of challenges. We have to have a vacuum atmosphere, and pouring should be done in a proper way, because vacuum investment casting facility is required, which is highly expensive. Technology kind, ALD kind of vacuum investment casting, only available very few locations in India, or maybe HAL and one more private producer from Gujarat, 3-4 people are having. So when we talk about metal, when the regular material comes, the manufacturing by using additive is not, may not be economical, but when we talk about a specific material and specific requirement, like as the implants or aerospace components, rotatory parts of aerospace engine parts, like as a multiple board system, what you have seen GE has developed, where additive can be able to support launch. Any kind of production challenges can be usually met in additive. And the post-processing plays a lot of role in additive manufacturing. It is not that much easy task. Build the part like in your plastic, remove the support material, fuse it and give it to the customer. Metals are not like that. While generating this support structure itself, we have to think twice how the thermal movements happen while printing and how the residual stress can be eliminated and how the possibility of removal of support material without giving much impression on the surface and how to give the machining allowance and also how it can be used as a functional requirement by considering metallurgical properties into factor. So, and then the heat treatment and heating, high isostatic processing, you know, preservation is the other technology is essential as a post-treatment technologies for while producing a rotatory components for the aerospace requirement. So having a metal additive manufacturing, having a proper post-processing, having a proper heat treatment support, having a heating support, we can say we can able to produce a wonderful requirement for the aero and as well as space requirement, both the cases. So now we will go to how some of the case studies I would like to say here. Whatever the case which you are seeing is a patient with a defect in the skull, met with an accident, a broken skull. I think you can see the CT will give you a clear idea. So this patient met with an accident, there is a damage in the skull. No material here, whatever the red color shown, it was a broken area where the material. So this attempt was made in 2003 in collaboration with the TMCH in Coimbatore. Usually conventional method, doctors used to prefer autologous rib graft, where the ribs would be removed from the same patient and split the ribs and close the damage and then close it with skin. So it's generally called a rib cranioplasty, close off defect with rib support. And one doctor from Coimbatore would like to try a different way. This is the case, you can see the damage in the skull. It is very clearly shown that this thing. So at the time, no implants or additive was not used for the implant manufacturing in 2002 and 3 and all. Metal additive manufacturing was not much familiar in those years. So, but doctor would like to use additive to produce a part, medically compatible part to fill this gap and would like to eliminate rib graft technology here. So what, how the TIFAC was supported them, doctor and engineer sit together, developed a 3D model by using imageware software to fill this gap. So doctor was sitting along with engineer, giving all the input about the wall thickness to be maintained and how the curvature to be done and how the angles to be done and keeping a CT image simultaneously, sitting with a design engineer, developed a 3D model and then using that 3D model, a template was produced in FDM by using ABS material. But unfortunately, this material cannot be used as the implant because it's not a biocompatible. And the doctor would like to use this as a template for the acrylic processing by using vacuum casting. So this is the biocompatible material we use. So this template was produced and given to doctor. A soft mold was generated out of this one by using medical compatible silica material. And then yes, a doctor imported a compatible, medical compatible acrylic plastic material from abroad and casted it. And it was successfully used on the skull of a patient. And patient is still alive and still in contact. And these are the planning Mrs. Sen, and the defect was exposed clearly, and surgical planning being done, and so it was inserted inside with titanium strips and screws used to attach this one into the skull. And finally, this was completed. Compared to the ring graft, this particular fixation had given better support, better strength to the skull, to the patient. This was probably the first attempt additive was used in medical side, that too for the cranioplasty kind of maxillofacial kind of requirement. This radiograph confirms the material presence inside. And this is a case prior to surgery and after surgery. So this was the thing. And this is the skull of a 10-month baby. A highly complex surgery happened at one hospital in Coimbatore. Since the age of the patient is critical of 10 months, a small baby, they would like to do, it's called a twisted skull or something like this, what was using technical term. But doctor would like to conduct the surgery on the skull. Some trials should be made to plan his surgery in a perfect way. One way to reduce the complexity during surgery after opening the head, the other way to reduce the time of the surgery, duration of the surgery. So we received a CT data from the doctor. All the correction, whatever the required portions to be retained in the skull being kept inside, the rest of the things being removed in the CT or in the 3D model itself. And we produced a 3D output and given to doctor to had given opportunity to conduct this rehearsal on this skull to plan the surgery. In fact, without this, the surgery might have been taken the duration of more than 10 hours, whereas the duration was reduced by 50%. And complexity, understanding the complexity to doctor also very well. And this is the lower jaw of the patient met with an accident. There is a damage in the lower jaw, you can see. So this, it's a kind of maxillofacial surgery. The patient would like to retain his aesthetic in this jaw portion, as like how it was looking prior to accident. So this surgery was done at one hospital in Hero. So they interacted with us. We had developed a broken jaw CT data and given that to doctor. And doctor used a titanium strip here to take the flow of jaw. You can see here the broken area also being covered here. And used rib graft here again. Removed the ribs from the various part of the same patient. And this was successfully incorporated to the patient. It's a kind of recraft technology. So these are the things largely used. I have not included some of the developments here. We have used even additive largely to produce teaching aids, not only for the medical and even for the engineering side also. One student was used this SLS. Even in SLS, we have a metal option in selective versus sundering. That is a two-stage process. The first stage, the raw material is basically steel powder coated with a plastic material. So the laser is not much powerful to melt the metal powder, so that it melt the plastic material and merge the parts together. So the first development happened in the machine would be the green part, which was taken to the post-processing by using furnace and by capillary action, infiltration being done by using bronze along with that one. So bronze infiltration at high temperature, eliminate the plastic material from there, and wherever the pores developed, filled with bronze. So the final output would be somewhat combination of bronze and steel. Strength is to be equal to tool steel. That was the technology given by the machine supplier. The same thing was used for various applications. Even a student was used to develop a drill bit with holes to pass the coolant inside during the drilling process to reduce the temperature of the tool and increase the life of the bit actually. So such a kind of development. And also the other interesting development done was development of trachea. Generally, if you go to doctor, bronchoscopy, we used to call it as endoscopy kind of thing. A doctor takes all the fresh doctors also use the patient as a trial version. And it hurts the patient a lot because the doctor doesn't know how the camera should be moved. So to solve this issue, we developed a physical model of trachea and given to doctor. And the doctors will be trained using bronchoscopy in the proto model so that they can train in that where and all the nook and corners, how to move the camera inside, all the training will be done so that they can use it very easily in patient cases when it comes. So that one thing is doctor can learn easily without much difficulty. And second thing, patient will not be hurt much. And we supported to develop some sort of recently, somewhat around 1.5 years back, a 14-year-old boy has a thymoma, a tumor in between three important organs, heart, lungs, and liver. A size of around 130 mm tumor in between all the three organs. It was pushing lungs and livers to some extent. So while removing that tumor, doctor was very much, doctor has to take a lot of care. Because it's not hurt the two important organs, lungs and liver. If any hurt happens, the surface bleeding end up with different kind of issues. So almost all the major hospitals in Tamil Nadu was not ready to accept this case. And we have been included into the discussion, and we produced two proto models and given opportunity to doctor. By using flexible plastic materials, by using G750 Stratasys 1. And the doctor conducted the rehearsal surgery, two attempts he had done it, and he developed it. That given a lot of confidence to doctor to go hard for the surgery. And they have done the surgery successfully, and the patient is alive, and they succeeded in the surgery also. Kind of lot of thing we used to do for medical application, monthly at least 2-3 thing we do. So as far as aerospace concerned, we are supporting with lot of research kind of thing we do. As such, we don't have a metal machine with us since we are going to buy an EBM soon. But we are sourcing all the requirements from outside with the supporters, with the machine suppliers like GE or SLM Solutions or EOS to produce parts for all the research, because where we used to support them to develop a machine parameters for the regular production of the parts into the array, kind of research, collaborative research which we are doing at present with Mittal. So I think with this short presentation, I would like to conclude here, and any questions, welcome now. Thank you, Mr. Dr. Karnagaran. Hello.
Sir, thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Karnagaran, sir, I hope Karnagaran, sir, has disconnected due to internet.
Okay.
All right, thanks. I'll wind up. You are on there, sir. Thank you, sir.
Any, hello?
Yes, sir. It's a very nice presentation, sir.
Thank you very much. So if in case
dear participant, if you have any doubts, queries, you can ask now.
No.